I can't remember when you weren't there, when I didn't care for anyone but you. I swear we've been through everything there is. Can't imagine anything we've missed. Can't imagine anything the two of us can't do. Through the years, you've never let me down. You've turned my life around. The sweetest days I've found with you. Through the years, I've never been afraid. I've loved the life we've made, and I'm so glad I stayed right here with you through the years. I can't remember what I used to do, who I trusted, who I listened to before. I swear you've taught me everything I know. Can't imagine needing someone so. But through the years it seems to me I need you more and more. Through the years, through all the good and bad, I know how much we had. I've always been so glad to be with you. As long as it's okay, I'll stay with you. I can't remember when you weren't there, when I didn't care for anyone but you. I swear, we've been through everything there is. Can't imagine anything we've missed. Can't imagine anything the two of us can't do. Through the years, you've never let me down. You've turned my life around. The sweetest days I've found with you. Through the years, I've never been afraid. I've loved the life we've made, and I'm so glad I stayed right here with you through the years. I can't remember what I used to do, who I trusted, who I listened to.
I'm going to attempt to narrate this video to give a little context so you can know what it's all about. As we begin, this first video is in front of our house that we lived in Abbeville, South Carolina. We called it the Old Rock House. That's Greg in the front, myself behind, my dad in front of his 55 Buick. And there, of course, is Greg and my dad again and myself in the ditch. Here, Frances, my mother's sister, is visiting. Aunt Frank is what we called her, and that's her husband, Charlie. Charles Jeffords in the front there, and they're walking up with Greg, and of course, Uncle Charlie's giving my mother a hug. There's my mother along with Greg. And there's Greg and myself, and that is actually in the old house where we live right now. This was made by my uncle. It was his house, Uncle Charlie Jeffords' house at the time. Here we are at the beach. Greg is unhappy. Something's going on. He didn't have his inner tube or something, so my dad's trying to pacify him and make him happy again. So there he is. He's a little bit upset, but of course he'll get over it in just a few minutes. Here we are again back in Abbeville in front of the house. This is the old rock house, and Greg on his tricycle. This video clip is of Greg and myself. My mother's getting us ready to go to the, we're about to leave, go to the meeting at the Kingdom Hall in Abbeville. And so she's having us walk back and forth just to get some video of us. I'm glad she did it. This is Greg with his tricycle. So here momentarily we're going to be leaving to go to the meeting. This is my mom with Greg coming out of the house, and you can see she's got a little something poking out there in the front, and that's my baby brother Philip just before he was born. She's well along with her pregnancy. She's loading us up to go to the Kingdom Hall in my dad's Renault with the gangster white walls on it. That's our old dog. This is something I remember Greg doing, sitting in the planting pot, the planter, and he's shaking his legs just as happy as he can be. This is my mother's parents, Mr. Willie and Grandma Rush, and they have Greg. He has Greg by the hand, and Grandma has me by the hand. And the idea was we were going to go home with them. Of course, that didn't happen, and Greg was not brave enough to go as far as I did, and I probably wouldn't have went home either. This is my dad's telephone truck. He's taking us, no doubt, maybe to the office where he worked. But there we go. All of this is still in Abbeville. Here's Greg drinking milk, and you can see there's another glass of milk there for me. My mother kept us in milk, and of course Greg loved milk right up to the very end. He always kept a gallon of milk in his refrigerator. He was a milk drinker. And we had some cookies to go along with that too, I'm sure. This is interesting. Greg's painted up with lipstick, some of my mother's red lipstick. We did it without her knowing it. We were going to play Cowboys and Indians, so I got an axe and we went out in the woods. And so when my mother came to look for us, she saw me with the axe and thought I'd hit Greg in the head with it. So she liked to fainted. But of course, no harm done. And I'm working on a drink there. We didn't get those very often back then. I don't even can't even tell what kind of drink it is. Looks like it's a no name or something. But of course, they didn't have no names back then, so it's probably just a Coke or something. But you can tell I'm getting the good out of it. Of course, this is about Greg, and we see him right there with me. We were always together when we were children. We lived out in the country. There were just no other people around, so we were close. Here we are with our stick horses. You know, I don't suppose that they have stick horses these days. There's just too many realistic games and so forth. But when we were children, that was really a fun thing to have, was a stick horse. And there's an old dog. That's actually the dog that bit me and left the scars on the left side of my head. His name, we called him Butt. Here's myself, Greg, and Mama with the baby, the newborn Philip. And one thing you'll notice, I don't know why I wasn't happy, but we had ringworms in our heads. And so my mother was so afraid, you'll see in a minute, you'll see a little circle, the patch. She was so afraid that we would give ringworm to the baby. You can see that round patch there in my head. And Greg had one too. This is myself and Greg. You can see myself with a swole eye swole shut, and Greg's walking on his left foot tilted up because we had been fighting wasps. I got stung in the face, and Greg got stung on the foot. So that was, one of our pastimes, and we still weren't afraid of them. We'd still fight them. Coming here is a lady that helped my mother. She lived across the street from us. Her name was Maggie. I don't know her last name, but we called her Aunt Maggie, and we loved her, and she loved us. Greg had been to the mailbox to get mail. It was a pretty good little walk out to the mailbox from where the house was there. And so he's a happy little fella. Now we're in Myrtle Beach. This is the first house behind the first house we lived in Myrtle Beach. This is myself and Greg and a little girl from across the street. And here you see myself, Greg, and Philip. And just a nice close-up picture of Greg loving up on Philip. These were 8 millimeter films. Several years ago, I had them converted. Now this is myself, Jeff Rush, and Greg in the rear at Brook Green Gardens. This is Greg and Philip. Greg has come up with this game where he puts the hat on Philip's head and then knocks it off, and he just laughs and laughs. And I actually can remember that. Boom, there goes the hat. See Greg laughing. This is in front of Harold Boggs, my mother's sister and her husband's house in Greenville, South Carolina. They'd had snow. This is Greg at the Kingdom Hall, the old Kingdom Hall in Myrtle Beach in front. And here is some family and friends. That's Greg. This is Brett Boggs. I think that's Jeff Rush in the car. And they had a flat. They were changing the flat tire. It seemed like we had a lot more flat tires when I was kids than we do nowadays with the radials. But that's Uncle Bill, my mom's brother there. That's the reason I included that. And this is Elaine, Jeff's sister, older sister. And I think that's Fran there, and Philip there, and this is my dad and Harold Boggs changing a tire. That's Vicky Rush. There's Jeff on the left and Greg on the right. There's Greg when he was first starting to ride a bicycle. Of course, Philip. He's just starting to walk good. This next picture is Greg playing with a football. Now that was a white football, and it was one they used to use at night. My dad played high school football, and he won that as a game ball, one of his one of the games he played in, and we wore that football out. I regret it now. It'd be nice to have it as a keepsake, but it's long gone. And that's of course Philip and Greg with my mom at the beach. And you can see Greg's in a happier mood now than he was the last time. And that's the Ocean Forest Hotel in the background there. And that's Greg. And here's on the left is Van Coffin, myself. That's Greg in the middle and myself on the right. Ned, Greg, and Philip. And here's Greg and Philip. Greg and Philip. This is a vacation we took to the mountains with the Boggs family, and you can see that's Philip in front of my dad there, Fran, Russell on the left, Greg, and that's Brett coming up. There's Greg, there's myself. And here in just a moment, you'll see my dad in the pool, and Greg, there's Greg trying to swim to him. So now we're in Tennessee now. We've moved to Tennessee. This was in about 67. I played Little League Baseball. I was a pitcher, and Greg was my catcher for practicing. So, and that's his little dog when we first got him there, you just saw in the picture. And here we are. This is the second place we lived in Tennessee. Daddy had 14 acres there and had cows. And that's Greg with his dog. His name's Mutt, too. It's not the same animal, same dog we had in Abbeville. It's a different one, but we named him Mutt as well. It's Greg and Philip playing with him. Of course, he was Greg's dog. He was a one-man dog. One boy dog, I should say. There's Greg with his dog and the horse that we had at the time. Lady is what we called her. He's taking her in the barn, but she doesn't cooperate. Some reason, I don't know if he was taking in to feed her or what. She was pregnant at the time. We had a little one later on. Now, this is now in Georgia, in the house we lived in Georgia. This is my mom and dad and Philip there in the picture. And I've included this clip because it shows just a really brief clip of Greg holding Tony when he was a baby. And that was out in the lane there. And, of course, this is Daddy and Greg on the back porch of that same house. Here they are on the front porch, Greg and my mom and Tony, and of course that's Philip in the picture there too. This next picture I really like because it's just a good picture of my dad and Greg together. And Greg was very much, personality-wise, was much more like my dad. My dad was quiet. Greg was quiet. They didn't have much to say, but when they did say, you could say something, you could listen to it. Of course, there is a Philip. He likes to cut. He liked to cut up. He was just a boy. And there's Elaine and Tony. We're getting ready to go home, back to Soperton. We lived in Soperton up in Middle Georgia at the time, and my parents were in South Georgia in Moultrie. There's Greg with his car that he had souped up. It was a 65 Mustang. It had a 351 in it, and that thing would run. He took it to the drag strip and so forth. And this is a picture of him visiting us in Soperton. Now we've moved to Darlington, and this is Greg. This is in kind of out in front of his house to the side. We had a snow that time, and Lindsay was little, Greg's daughter. And we were pulling her and Becky and the other children on we had a little John Deere tractor, and we were pulling them on a sled behind it around on the snow. This is my parents' 50th wedding anniversary, and the man taking the picture there is Elson Petty from Myrtle Beach. We've known him since we were children, and he's setting up for a family picture there of us five. And, of course, that's in the rear is Philip on the left, me in the middle, Greg on the right, and along with my parents. So this was really an amazing event for my parents that all three of us worked together to put on. We had a really big shindig. A lot of people were there, and I know I've always said it's one of the best things I ever did for my parents, particularly my mother. She was overwhelmed, and by the time the pictures were being taken, she was really tired. But I put this picture in here just to show a more recent picture of Greg. This was made in 1997, in October of night or November 1st, 1997, is when this was done, right after my parents' anniversary. And this is the last clips I'll show of Greg. It was just at Kingdom Hall for my dad's memorial in 2013. In the rear there is Gerald Smith, and there's some other families and friends. A lot of people were there at the memorial. And that's Greg talking to Lena McLeod first, and then Patricia Gandy. So this concludes these video clips. I just really like to do this. I'd like putting this on because it shows a progression of Greg down through the years. So appreciate you looking at it. I hope you really, if you're family members, I hope you saw and remember some of the things that were there.
To be reading the obituary at the family's request. I am only reading a portion of it. You are more than welcome to read the rest of it at your leisure. I'm going to read the first paragraph and the last two paragraphs. Russell Gregory Little was born on December 31st, 1956 in Anderson Memorial Hospital in Anderson, South Carolina. The family was living in Abbeville, South Carolina at the time. He was the son of James Oscar Little and Julia Agnes Rush Little. He was always known by the name Greg to friends and family. Greg was the middle of three boys who were very close and loved each other. Greg had it in him to be as good-hearted a person as you could ever meet. He was kind-hearted and was generous to a fault. He had a hard time saying no when he was asked to help out. Greg is survived by his daughter, Lindsay Little Glass, who is married to Brian of Moultrie, Georgia, and by his older brother, Ned, who is married to Elaine of Darlington. Also, one niece, Rebecca Ann Brock, who is married to Terry of Hartsville, and two nephews, Anthony Ned Little, who is married to Miranda, and James Bryant Little, who is married to Ashley, both of Darlington, and one aunt, Martha Little Cawthon, who is married to Lynn of Anderson, South Carolina. He was predeceased by his parents, James Oscar Little and Julia Rush Little, and his younger brother, Philip Allen Little, who is married to Dana.
Thank you, Jimmy. You know, Greg was a special kind of person in my estimation. There were some things about him that were unique. He was quiet, he was an introvert. I was more the extrovert, but it's really a strange thing when I look back on it that Greg, especially as we got into our teen years, he was the one that made friends, and I just adopted his friends. So it seems that people liked him better than me, and really, I can understand it because of his disposition, his mildness, and so forth. You know, he was really was a kind, good-hearted person, as the obituary stated, and one of the things that he always liked to do was to help other people, and he did this in many ways, but I remember one thing in particular. Greg was an excellent mechanic from his youth onward. Really, I remember him rebuilding an engine on his own when he was about 16 years old and in a car. So he did that his whole life, and he was good at it. So when some of the ones, his acquaintances, friends, so forth, would have automobile problems, maybe they weren't doing so well materially, he would fix their car for free. Or maybe just accept whatever they could offer. And so that's the kind of person he was. He was always willing to give, and if you ask him for something, he'd let you have it. And so I've always appreciated that about him. In fact, as I said, I think the obituary said in some cases he was generous to a fault. Greg and I were always close. We've lived together just next door to each other for over 40 years now. And prior to that, when we were growing up, Greg was only a year and 4 months younger than me. And so everything we did together. And for a lot of our growing up, we lived in rural areas, somewhat isolated, and we really didn't have an opportunity to have much association besides with each other. And so that really caused us to be even closer. So what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to relate a few stories that were close to my heart, close to his, about some of the things that happened as we were growing up. Some of them hopefully are entertaining. And, you know, he and I talked about these different things and we'd laugh about them and enjoy them. And for instance, Greg and I, when we grew up, it was certainly a different world than what we see today. You know, parents didn't have to have their children on a leash. You know, they could just kind of turn them loose. Especially out in the country, you didn't have to worry about your children. And so we had a lot of freedom to do the things that we wanted to do. We really were ramblers. We did things. And I don't mean that in a bad way. We just were always outside. At that time, there wasn't anything to keep children inside, unless they were bookworms, and we certainly weren't that. There were no Game Boys, no Wiis, no, even TV. TV, there was nothing to interest children during the week. So anytime we were up, we were outside if it was at all possible. And so when we lived in Myrtle Beach, I think Greg was about 4 when we moved there and 9 when we moved away. My Uncle Bill, my mom's brother, brought us a pony. And we built a place in the backyard. My dad built a little barn. The little barn's still there, matter of fact. I saw it not too long ago. And we kept that pony in the backyard. We rode and rode, and we rode double. And then my uncle brought us a horse a little later. And so now we had a horse and a pony. And we rode the legs off of those animals. We were all over the north end of Myrtle Beach riding those animals. And Myrtle Beach was not what it is now by any stretch of the imagination. In fact, our home where we live was probably 3 or 4 blocks off of what now is a 17 North Bypass. It's a divided 4-lane highway through there. When we lived there, that was a narrow dirt road. And we could go down to that dirt road, and it went all the way up to the north of Myrtle Beach and came out to the south down at 501. So we had a lot through there. We could cross over that dirt road and go through the woods down to the intercoastal. And here we were just little children, but those were the kinds of things we were doing. And we really enjoyed life, I have to say. And so after we left Myrtle Beach, Greg was between 9 and 10 when we moved to Tennessee. We moved up to Tennessee, and the first house we lived in there, we lived about a half a mile from a pond that we had found. And to get to that pond, it was a little bit of a trip because we had to cross a highway and then go through the woods, cross a fence, and then across a long pasture. And so one of the things some of you know about the Littles is that for generations, we make turtle stews, and it's a family ritual. So all of us get involved, we sample and taste and see what else needs to be added, and then we eat it together. And that's what we've done. At least I know my grandparents did, my parents did, and of course we do to this day. And so we would go and set hooks in this pond and catch these turtles. And some of the turtles we caught weighed over 20 pounds. And this is an example right here of about a 20-pound turtle. We caught that one summer of 2018. And you can see they're fierce animals. And you only can hold them by the tail, really. And so you can imagine a little boy 9 years old and an 11-year-old boy with a 20-pound turtle. We've got to carry that thing a half a mile. So we would begin carrying one of us, and one arm would get tired, and we'd swap arms, and then the other one would take it for a while, and then he'd swap arms. And so we did that till we got back home. Then we would kill him, and we would butcher him, take care of him. My mom was the architect in that at our age then. But nevertheless, that was a big thing for the family. So, we still to this day, he and I would look back fondly on some of those things that we did. And, I can't imagine my grandchildren doing such a thing as what we were doing there. It just wouldn't happen. And just another turtle incident. I'm moving forward for a minute just till after I was married. We still, when you can see, we still catch turtles to this day. Once we had some turtle hooks set behind my dad's home down in South Georgia. There was a pond behind the house. And so the farmer had irrigated out of that pond and dropped it down several feet. And right at the edge of the pond, the bank just went dropped straight off, and then the bottom went out. And so we had these hooks out there. So one evening after dark, I got Daddy's truck, and Philip, my baby brother, got right next to me, and Greg and his wife-to-be Barbara were on the outside. So we pull up to the edge of the pond. I'm going to check the turtle hook. So I tell Philip, I said, Philip, now I said, I'm going to check the hook. You hold your foot on the brake while I do that, because there was a little slant down to the pond. Well, I jumped out of the truck. Philip jumped out of the truck, and the truck went in the pond. So you can imagine my father had some choice words to say about that. I remember, and I'll just, you know, clean it up a little bit. He says, the older you get, the more destructive you get. And that was true. I mean, how could I argue with that? So those are just a few things. Now, here, going back to Tennessee, though, I got a couple other things I want to share. One in Tennessee, once we were riding these horses, and we were out beyond the house. And we came to this big barn, and for some reason, I don't know why, we used to catch pigeons and stuff. We went up in the loft of the barn. And up in that barn, we found these three young screech owls. So we caught them and took them home. We built this nice big cage for them. We had them in there, you know, everything was just right. So we go back out there to check on them, and they're gone. We could not figure out how those owls got out of that cage. It just was no way. Well, of course, we found out our dad had turned them out. And you know, that's the right thing to do, because you shouldn't keep up wild animals like that. But, and you'd think we learned, but we didn't. Some years later, after we were living in South Georgia, by then I was driving. Greg and I were going along, and we on a dirt road, and we found these three baby skunks on the side of the road. So you know what happened? We caught them, we took them home, we kept them up, we were feeding them. We had grand plans. We thought we would get one of them descended maybe and keep it and sell the others or something like that. You know, that's what was in our minds. But we kept them a while. They were quite tame. And, that, you know, I don't know about skunks really, but they never did spray us. I don't know why, if little ones can't spray or what, but we didn't have any issue with that. But one day we go out and they're gone. We can't figure out how they got out. But of course, you know, Daddy struck again and doing the right thing. And, you know, just in a reflection on that, all three of us boys had great appreciation for our parents. They gave us a lot of freedoms. They let us be boys. And, you know, that's really the reason I've always felt like I'm who I am. And same for the other two. So we really owed a lot to our parents. I felt that way. Greg did, and so did Philip. Now, you know, I love Greg, and Greg loved me. There's no doubt. We both knew that. And I feel that because of that relationship that we had, because of the way I knew him, I'm able to speak for him on some things. And I'm also able to talk about him. Now, that's what I'm going to do. And if it, what I'm about to say helps even one person in a positive manner, I know that he would be delighted, because that's the kind of person he was. You know, the ones of us that knew Greg realized that he had a struggle with alcohol from his young adulthood. And he also was a lifelong cigarette smoker. Now, these two things are a deadly combination, and he knew it. And you might find this hard to believe, but he actually hated smoking. He tried many times to quit. He was often getting the peppermint candies and sucking on them, trying to cut back, trying to quit. He had some success with the alcohol here and there. He quit for lengths of time, but the cigarettes, the tobacco, was very much more difficult for him. And what do we learn from that? Well, this is a deadly black hole when someone gets addicted to tobacco. And so that's one of the things we want to learn from that. Greg tried to quit many times, but he really wasn't successful. So one of the things I'd like to do now is share the first scripture. And this is a scripture. It's in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 7 and verse 2. Now, I'm just going to read this and let you think about it for a moment. Now, wise King Solomon wrote this about 3,000 years ago. And he says this. He said, better to go to the house of mourning than to the house of feasting. For that is the end of every man, and the living should take it to heart. So do you see the point? If we can look at Greg's life and his pattern and see something we can do to help ourselves, again, that would be something that would please him. And so any of us maybe that have issues, you know, that are affecting our health or maybe our relationships, then we should give that attention, prayerful attention, especially our young ones. Now, you know, the CDC says that the of adults that smoke, almost 90% of them started before they were 18 years old. And I know Greg started well before that. And what does that tell you? These tobacco companies prey on young people. So if you're a youth and you've given that any thought, don't do it. You know, it's a dead end street and it'll cost you years off your life as this system goes on. So that's one of the things I know he would like for me to share with you. Young ones, never take up that habit. It'll shorten your life just as it shortened Greg's. You know, if he quit just a few years ago, in all likelihood, he would still have years of quality life left ahead of him. But we can't help him now. But we can help ourselves, and we can help the ones we love. So if you have habits like this, and about the alcohol for just a minute too. One of the things about alcohol is it can become habitual too, and it can cause you health problems. But the main thing that alcohol is known to do is destroy relationships. So you see people that lose control in that way damage their relationships with their family. And there was friction many times over the years between my brother and myself because of the way he used alcohol. Unfortunate. But again, we can't go back and undo that. But we can change the future for ourselves if we have issues in that regard. So if anybody has those kinds of habits, or and you can take this and apply it in other areas too, anything that we might do to hurt our health, make some adjustments. You know, there's a lot of illicit drug use today. There's also abuse of prescription drugs. These things are damaging. So don't allow it to impact you, your health, and your family. Do that for yourself. And if you don't do it for yourself, do it for the ones you love and for the ones that love you. You know, for Greg and myself, both of our grandfathers died when we were very young, both of them from smoking. One had lung cancer, the other one had heart disease. And so we can see, and we've known from our youth how damaging smoking was. And so anyhow, just the thought that I wanted to leave with you. I've lost others. I lost my father-in-law. Probably my mother-in-law died due to smoking too, even though she never smoked. And other uncles, family, friends, and so forth over the years. So do you see the value of that scripture that I read earlier? Take it to heart. Think about these things because it will benefit you. Now let's move on to something a little different. You know, most everybody here no doubt knows I'm one of Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, Greg wasn't, but I know for an absolute fact that he accepted the Bible truths as put forward by the witnesses. He was raised that way for one thing, but also over the years, I know what his thinking was about matters. And matter of fact, something I would like to relate to you is just about a month and a half before his death, his first wife, Barbara, had a conversation with him. They talked on the phone, and he told her that when the pandemic was over, he was going to start back going to the kingdom hall. So that really made me feel good. And he actually had said things like that to me as well. So I knew that that was on his mind. Of course, as most of you probably know, Jehovah's Witnesses haven't had any in-person meetings since March. And so that's all over the world. But we use Zoom just like we're using it right here. And it's worked out well for us. We've missed no meeting. So it's really benefited us. And we appreciate the technology that's available. So anyhow, Greg had on his mind returning to worship at the Kingdom Hall. So that brings up the question now, what did Greg believe about death and the hope for the future? Well, you know, we realize Jehovah's Witnesses are well aware of what mainstream religion teaches about what happens when you die. And of course, there's variations in what is taught. But, you know, it's good if we don't pay attention to the things that we hear or the things that other people believe or allow ourselves to be influenced by perhaps some sort of doctrines. We need to see what the Bible has to say about matters. And I want to share with you this scripture. It's in Ecclesiastes 9, 5 and 6. And I'm just going to read part of 5. It starts out by saying, "For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing at all." Now, I don't know how it could be any clearer than that for me. It says, when you're dead, you know nothing at all. And verse 6 goes on to say, there's no love, no hate, or no jealousy either. So there's no emotions there. So we see then what the scriptural precedent is for when you're dead, you're dead. And that's really the way Jehovah's Witnesses view the matter, as well as Greg did too. Now, when we see it like that, it really helps us to better understand something Jesus himself said in John chapter 5 and verse 28. Here in John 5, 28, Jesus says this. He says, do not be amazed at this, for the hour is coming in which all those in the memorial tomb will hear his voice and come out. Now, think on that just a moment. He says the ones in the memorial tomb at some point are going to hear the voice of Christ and they're going to come out. So what does that mean where they are now? Doesn't that have implications that they're nowhere right now? But eventually there's a hope that they can come back. And also further supporting this is something Apostle Paul said. It's in Acts 24:15. Now, in this particular case, this is an interesting instance here because some false accusations had been made against Paul and some of the early Christians. And so they were called before Roman governor Felix to make a defense of themselves. And that's what this whole account's about. But I'm just going to read verse 15, which is just one part of what Paul had to say. But it's pertinent to what we're talking about here. He says this to Felix, Governor Felix. He says, "And I have a hope toward God, which hope these men also look forward to, that there is going to be a resurrection of both the righteous and the unrighteous." So you see what Paul's saying there, that he, as well as the other Christians that are along with him, have this hope of a resurrection of both the righteous and the unrighteous. And so what does that mean? Now, it doesn't say the righteous and the wicked. It says the righteous and the unrighteous. Now, someone that's judged wicked by God, that's a different matter. And who will be resurrected and who won't be is in God's hands, and we can't say. But one thing we can say is just to quote a part of a scripture in Romans 6:7. It says, when someone dies, they have been acquitted from sin. Now think of what that means. You know, the sentence that Adam was given, if he sinned, he would die. So all of us have no choice. We're born sinners. We can't help it. We can try to live as best we can, but we still have the stain of sin on us. But the penalty for sin is simply death. So obviously then, according to the righteous judgment of our God, when a person dies, then they're acquitted from sin. And when they come back in the resurrection that Jesus himself talks about, they're going to have a clean slate. And it's what they do from that point forward is what matters. Now, my very favorite reference for talking about death and the hope for the future is the 11th chapter of John. Now, many of you who are Bible readers are no doubt well familiar with this account. This is the account of where Jesus' good friend Lazarus dies and is resurrected. But there's so much more to this account. Jesus is about 2 days away from Bethany, where Lazarus, Martha, and Mary live. And when he finds out that he's needed back in Bethany, he waits 2 more days before he leaves. So it ends up that it's 4 days before Jesus gets back to where Lazarus is dead. Now, there was a reason for that. In fact, Jesus even said that earlier in chapter 11. That there's a reason for what's happening. And what was the reason? Well, we can kind of surmise this by the discussion that went on between Martha and Jesus. And we're going to talk about that in just a minute. But Martha had no concept that it was a possibility that Lazarus could be resurrected. Because she told Jesus, she said, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died. So she knew Jesus could have healed him. But she also would have known about previous resurrections Jesus had done. But those previous resurrections were done soon after death. Here Lazarus has been dead 4 days. He has decomposed already. So could he be put back together? Not in Martha's mind. And there's another interesting point, too, that I found in a reference. And that is the Jewish people of Jesus' day had this belief that when a person died, their soul hovered over their body for 3 days. Now, none of this is scriptural. Not in their scriptures or ours. But they believed the soul hovered over the body for 3 days. And then after the third day, it wasn't possible for somebody to come back to life. So doesn't that help us to see perhaps why Jesus waited to the fourth day. See, that disproved this false belief, but also it showed that the resurrection was possible even from nothing. Because, see, you know, I hate to describe it like this, but Lazarus would have been jelly by now after 4 days. So you can see the intent there. Now, I want to go back to this discussion between Jesus and Martha, Lazarus' sister. And the reason for this is there's an account at the end of Luke chapter 10 where Jesus is in their home teaching them personally. That's just one account. He was probably there more than one time, and he probably talked to them about a number of things. But the point is, these people were taught by Jesus himself. So now let's pick up this conversation between Martha and Jesus. Martha approaches Jesus, and it's in verse 21 of John 11. Martha then said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." So again, I mentioned it. She knew he could have healed him. Now it's too late to resurrect him. And so in verse 23, though, Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." Now she didn't know that Jesus was talking about in the next few minutes. Here's what she thought. And this is no doubt what she was taught by Jesus himself. So this is very important. Listen to what Martha says back to him. Verse 24, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." You see the point? What her hope was? Here's somebody taught by Jesus himself. Now, if this had been an era, don't you think Jesus would say, "Oh no, Martha, you're wrong. He's already in heaven with the Lord." He didn't say anything like that. This has been able to stand now for 2,000 years as part of the Bible record. So clearly, that helps us to appreciate what the hope for our dead loved ones is. It's a resurrection at some point in the future. Now, the last scripture I'm going to use comes from the book of Job. Now, I use this purposely because Job was written by Moses. Job was a contemporary of Moses. That means what we're about to read is probably about 3,600 years old. So as we read this in Job chapter 14, I share this because what we're seeing from this is even the most ancient of servants of God, even before Judaism was established, they had a belief in the resurrection too. So listen to what Job says. He says this, verse 14 of Job 14, he says, "If a man dies, can he live again? I will wait all the days of my compulsory service until my relief comes. You will call, and I will answer you. You will long for the work of your hands." So this matter of compulsory service Job is mentioning here, he's talking about his time in the grave, that he knew he would spend time there, but one day God would call him back in a resurrection. And why? Well, Job says, because God has a longing for the work. That I love science. So modern science has helped us to understand a little bit more about the distinctiveness of every human being, unless you're an identical twin. Every human that's ever lived besides twins have had a distinct DNA. This was a DNA process that the Creator started in the Garden of Eden. And then as Adam and Eve had children, they passed on DNA, but different DNA to all their children. And then their children did the same thing all the way down to us today. So every one of us are a distinct work of art from the view of the Creator. If you think about an artist, a master artist, do they want any of their works to be mutilated, to be discarded, to be trashed, to be treated in some kind of manner other than being hung in a gallery where they can be enjoyed? No, they're proud of everything they've done. So our Creator is also proud of each one of us as works of his hands. And the Bible tells us he longs to bring us back. So one of these days, Jehovah's Witnesses are convinced we're living in the last days. Not too far on the horizon, there's a new order coming. At that point in time, we're going to see the resurrection begin. We will be restored to our dead loved ones. What a marvelous time that is to look forward to. You can't imagine how seeing someone you love come back, it'll undo all that grief. You'll forget about all the grief behind you. And so that's what we're looking forward to. And so I hope that this information just gives you a little something to meditate on. Again, this is the way Greg viewed things. This is the way I view things. we Jehovah's Witnesses view them. So hopefully you appreciate this information, and it concludes this memorial discussion. Now, we're going to have a song now, and what I would like for you to notice is that last scripture I read in Job 14 and 15, this song is based on those verses, and you'll see it. It has a visual to go along with it, the words are there, and of course the music. So enjoy the song, please. And then afterwards, our cousin Clay Smith will pray.
Life like a mist appears for just a day and disappears tomorrow. All that we are can quickly fade away, replaced with tears and sorrow. If a man should die, can he live again? Hear the promise God has made. He will call, the dead will answer. They will live at his command. For he will have a longing for the work of his own hand. So have faith and do not wonder, for our God can make us stand, and we will live forever as the work of his own hand. Friends of our God, though they may pass away, will never be forsaken. All those asleep, who in God's memory stay, from death we will awaken. Then we'll come to see all that life can be, paradise eternally.
Heavenly Father, Jehovah, we come before you now in prayer to ask that you would be with us, and especially with all of our family, especially Ned and Elaine. We know that we also thank you so much for the preserving the Bible for our records and for our benefit. And from that Bible record, we understand what your purpose for humankind was. Not to be to death, not to be destined for death. Your original purpose was to have perfect earth, filled with perfect human beings. also that study of the Bible helps us to appreciate that that purpose hasn't changed. You are going to bring those, as Ned mentioned, bring those memorial tombs back to life. We look forward to that time we can see Greg again. But in the meantime, that purpose gives us hope and belief and comfort. Please accept this prayer and ask for your forgiveness in Jesus Christ's name.
Nice service, Ned. Really appreciate it. I know Greg would have too. Hope you and Lane are doing well, buddy.
Yep.
Nice job. I just want to get some of that turtle soup.
That was a very nice service.
Yes, very good.
Nice job, Ned. Nice to see you. Hey,
good to see you, buddy.
Nice to see you. Real smart about Greg.
Yeah. Ned, we want to see more pictures.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was good, Brother Little and James.
Enjoy that.
All right. I didn't know you was doing the turtle soup too.
And really enjoyed getting to know your family better.
Oh, well, thank you.
Really nice.
I like the old times, Ted.
Yeah.
You asked me long ago when we went walking and barefooted. It's just wonderful, I mean, to see that, because I remember those days.
Yeah, I know Myrtle Beach has changed a lot, but they're probably still looking for the little boys down there.
There's probably wanted posters on the light poles.
What kind of dress?
Good job. Yes,
very nice. The boys, where those came from.
Hi, Lisa. Hi, Charlie.
Ned, I appreciated your talk. Sorry to hear about Greg.
Good to see you too, man. I haven't seen you in quite a while.
Yeah, I just heard about that today, so I'm glad I made the talk. You guys take care. Okay?
You do the same.
I enjoyed the stories.
Yeah, it was nice.
Hey, Ned, are most of these folks from your congregation or just from all over?
Some of them are criminals. Some.
I thought I recognize them from the
Donaldson
gang.
You notice a lot of them don't have the video going. They're trying to stay hidden.
Don't want to be accused.
I have a legit reason for mine.
But he don't ever change. I tell you.
That was so.
I have a big
job, man. Very good job.
Yeah. Where are
they? All right now.
Hey, Lindsay.
Edie and Brian.
Oh, hey, Ned and Elaine.
All right.
A great job.
Nobody's been calling you bad names again, have they, Frank?
Hey, you know how it is, Ned. Pretty bad.
I tell you, Ned, I'm getting tired of these services. We went to one Friday, Saturday afternoon. This is the third one, so I'm about to.
Well, I don't have to do anymore. I thought about this for a long time. In fact, Joe, I was thinking about getting you to do it.
I'm glad Elaine talked you out of it.
Ned.
Yeah.
Hey, it's Lisa. My mom is on here listening, but she was going to say hello, but she doesn't know how to get her microphone turned on. How does she do that on the phone?
Yeah, we love you, Betty.
Hi, Betty. This is Deborah. We love you.
Hey, Debbie Walters.
Yeah, I tell you.
I think something's wrong with my speaker. I tried to say hello, but I don't. Now I think it's working. I don't know.
Yeah.
I wanted to say that Ned, that was, I loved your talk. It was so good. I enjoyed going down
Virginia. This right here, this is our double cousin from
California.
I couldn't watch the pictures ahead of time. I turned all that off. So that thing is just too heart-wrenching, you know, to watch those old pictures.
Yes.
Although I can say that swelling on your eye hasn't seemed to have gone down any.
Take him to the woodshed, Ned. Oh my.
Jason, how you doing? Jason, friend. How are you?
Yeah.
Hello, Dee. Hello, William.
Hey. Oh, I didn't see Jason there. How you doing?
So nice to see all my old friends from long ago.
Yeah. It's been a long time. Jason's
been a long time. Yeah. It's been a long time.
See him. Okay. All right.
Oh, this is the best part of it right here.
Yeah.
How are you doing, Marilyn?
Mm-hmm.
Who is that? Oh, that's Lindsay.
Hey,
Lindsay.
Hey.
I didn't know who that Baylet was.
That's Greg's daughter. Hey, how are y'all?
Hey.
Oh, nice service, Ned. I sure appreciate that.
Thank you.
Oh, there she is.
Yeah. Jackson. Hey, Jason.
Yeah.
Oh, that was nice.
Like your daddy. I was surprised when I saw your lady.
Oh, there she is.
Yeah,
I get a lot of features.
That one that's in pages.
Yeah.
Called me last night, Lindsay.
Do what now?
Guess who called me last night?
Who?
Frankie Banks.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
That was one of his old racing buddies, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's great.
Hey, Nina Lane.
Yeah, me.
They own a breakout race.
She waving. I tell you. Yeah.
I couldn't hear what you said, Daddy. Say that again.
I said, I appreciate everyone coming on.
Almost missed it, but I got the tail end. I got to come over and see those pictures, man. I missed the pictures.
Yeah, that was very good.
That's what they say. Okay.
We're planning to play them again when we get done talking here. But okay. Yeah,
what's that behind you, Lindsay?
That's my mom.
No, it's not. Hey, Barbara.
Oh, wow. Hey, Barbara. It was such a great service.
Camera. Love the hair, Barbara.
Hey, Barbara.
So is that gray hair, Barbara, or what?
Well, you know, a little color here and there to cover up a lot of gray.
Taking so long, I don't know.
She keeps the color so it doesn't come out.
That's all right.
I love the picture.
Yeah, all right.
Hey, Lindsay, are you in IT by any chance?
Am I what?
Do you do IT work?
No, well, sometimes at work I do.
Okay, I was wondering, I went through, I think it was a CBT campus, and have you ever gone through them for anything?
No.
Okay, well, there's another Lindsay Little that lives down there in Georgia that I saw their review, and I was like, I didn't know you were in IT, but... That makes sense now.
No, I'm not. And there's actually another Lindsay Glass as well.
Yeah, you did a great job. I got through that talk with them after those victims. They had me choked up. I don't know how you did it, but you did a great job.
Hey, Mia.
Thank you.
Hey,
bye, Ed. Bye, Lane.
You all.
Really proud of you.
Way back there, Jonathan.
Yeah, good to see you guys.
All right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Good to see you.
All right. Bye bye.
Oh,
Hi, Barbara. I don't know if you remember me at all. It's Lisa. Gerald's daughter.
You love too, haven't you?
I do. I babysit you a many a day.
I remember that. You had the Grease album. Oh, we used to listen to the Grease album with you.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Hey. Hey. How are you?
I said, Dwight, you've lost your locks too, haven't you?
Say that again?
I said, you've lost your locks too, haven't you?
Yeah, crazy, huh? Tell you what. Oh, yeah. And these Zoom cameras, they don't do you no favors neither. they don't give you nothing.
Hey, were we supposed to play these pictures again, or are we not going to do that again?
Maybe, I don't know.
Yeah, I'd love to see them.
Yeah.
Y'all want to run through the pictures one more time?
Yeah.
Yeah, please.
Okay, it's only about...
Ned, we got to go. I got a meeting to go to.
Okay.
I'll call you guys later. See ya.
Bye-bye. We have to
I love you guys. Bye, Leah and Bud Pritchett.
All right, so I'll go ahead and share them, and anybody wants to stay and watch, feel free.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Bye, everybody.
Yeah. That one picture was him beside Uncle Bill on that couch. It looked like Uncle Bill was saying, "It's a big couch." He was all up on him in that picture.
That's
on the couch.
A little brother. That's just a little brother, what Jimmy's talking about.
What now?
The one you talking about, Jim, is that Sister Little's brother?
Yes.
I can tell. You can tell.
Yeah, look just like
her. Him and her had very much the same complexion and facial shape and everything.
I'm telling you, I got to be her brother. Yeah. And then the one with them two sitting again look like Jimmy on with a wig on his head. And
this one right here?
Yeah, that's the one I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's saying it's a big couch.
I know.
He's sitting so close.
Yeah. You got to be right up under me. Oh, wow.
He must have something important to tell him.
Yeah. Yeah. Not a word.
I'm telling you.
I'm telling you. You look right down my throat when I'm talking to you. Mm-hmm. Make sure you get it.
And then the one with you with the long hair.
Yep.
You and your daddy had on camp just a lot.
What do you say?
I said, I've got some more that's worse than that I can show you.
Look like Jim with a wig on.
I remember them long hair pictures, Ned.
Ned. Good job, Ned. Very good.
That was excellent putting it together. Yeah. Like that.
Is this one here?
Yeah, that's the one.
Oh, wow.
Ned, can you share with them how Greg went from stick straight hair to curly hair?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that would be good.
Before that happened, though, Martha, we knew her when we were children in Tennessee.
Okay.
She, I always say she's my older sister. What she did was she taught Greg how to put peroxide and lemon juice on his hair and make it blonde. And she did it. So Greg was blonde for a while, but when we worked for the farmer in Tennessee, in Georgia, rather. That farmer was always picking at us and everything. So one day he just took some scissors and just cut a big whack out of Greg's hair.
Wow.
So Greg couldn't do nothing, but yeah, he got it shaved down to the scalp. And when his hair came back, it was curly. It had always been straight before that.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness. I mean, here lately, when he died, his hair was just as straight as mine. Well, what I got left.
Wow.
His hair wasn't curly anymore. So I don't know.
Wow.
That's great.
But those were really good pictures. Yes. And the way you put it all together, Ned, yeah. I tell you, it was excellent.
Yep. I love Kenny G, too.
Kenny Rogers. Kenny Rogers music. Yeah. That was put together real good.
Yeah. I knew you put a lot of work into that, man.
Yeah, I did. It's working now. And I also ordered some, Greg and Philip both were cremated, so there's nothing left of them. But I ordered some monuments and I put put a concrete pan down by the pond and put those monuments down.
Oh, okay.
That's what that picture was at the very end.
Okay.
Yesterday.
Oh, that's nice.
Mm-hmm. That one right there.
Yeah. Oh, no.
Wow.
Oh,
okay.
And when they come, when you put it down, I got to come see them.
They're down already.
Are they really? Okay.
At the pond.
All right, we'll ride out there, but I'm not going to let Rob do any fishing now, okay?
Just while you're out.
Rob, you probably just didn't leave her home.
I tell you what. Y'all might, you and Rob might go hunting. But on rabbits.
Nate, will you catch the squirrel? No, turtles.
Turtles.
Turtle.
Huh? Lindsay, it's nice to see you. Your grandma sent me a picture of you when you were probably about 5 or 6 years old. I still have it. She was proud of you.
That's been a long time ago.
Yeah. You went with us to Ohio to see her.
No, you went on one trip when we went way up north and we had a bandit.
I think I got a picture of her in Ohio.
No, Debbie Springs went with us to Ohio.
I think Lindsay went with us to Tennessee.
Yes, I think so. That's right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I got some pictures of that too.
Uh-huh.
Your pictures are scattered all over the country, Lindsay.
I know.
Well, I got mine from your grandma as a gift in the mail, so it's legit.
That's been a long time ago. I just turned 37, so that's been a long time ago.
Yeah, it's probably. Because you were tiny, you were little.
Right. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. I had actually video of you on that sled and then pulling you and Becky together.
I remember that. That was so much fun. Oh, my gosh.
One of the few times we got enough snow to play in it.
I know. Exactly.
That's back when we used to have the snow bowls with the crew from... Yeah.
Tell Dee about the turtle.
You asked where the turtle was.
Where do you get them from?
That particular one there, we caught down at Lane's parents' pond in Georgia.
That was a big turtle.
You can set a hook for them and catch them. Sometimes we would find them just crossing a road somewhere, you know, and you just grab them while you can. Like in the spring, I think they move a lot around.
Just make sure you grab the back end, not the front end.
Yeah.
Well, you know, some people go and fill under the banks and keep finding them like that. I don't know if my uncle would do that. I went with him one time doing it. But
you call that noodling?
Well, yeah. We have problems, I think, it's something like that.
Ned, everybody, we're going to jump off.
All right. Thank you.
Glad you're fine.
Thank you for letting us join you. Bye, everybody.
Bye, Emily.
Bye-bye.
Love you. Bye-bye.
But I think I'm going to go myself, so I'm not needed here anymore.
Yeah, that's Jim.
Good to see you all.
Good to see you, Jimmy.
Bye, Lindsay.
Bye.
Jason. Nice to see that mustache, Jason.
Yes, sir. I'm losing hair. I got to keep hair somewhere.
Yeah. Hi, Emily, Martha.
Bye.
Everybody else I can talk to.
Bye, Jimmy.
Anytime. All right, bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank
you. We appreciate the support. So, very much.
All right.
Bye, you guys. Love you,
Ned,
Elaine.
Thank you,
baby.
Love you.
Okay. Well, before too long.
All right. Okay.
Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye, Emily.
Bye, Liz.
I'm going to leave too, so it's good being with all of you guys and seeing you. And thank you so much for inviting me, Ned. Really appreciate it.
Bye, sweetie.
Yeah.
Hey, Sean, I see you're on here.
Oh, yeah. She's on there.
Yeah.
All right, y'all have a good evening. Love you, Nate.
Bye.
Get it right. Y'all have a good evening. Love y'all.
All right. I guess we'll see you soon, Lindsay.
Okay, we'll see y'all later.
All right.
Bye.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Nate, you did a good job.
Thank you.
I'm going to see you guys
right now. Boy, I was so stressed last night thinking about this thing.
Oh.
Wow.
I can only imagine.
You know, it's just got to go right. So.
Did a great job, man.
Thank you.
The Littles.
Yeah.
I've been quiet, but next Saturday morning, you're mine.
Look,
that's right. I thought I was a devil's little child, but Skunk's brother Little, Skunk's.
You should have spoke up while the cousins were
out
here.
I didn't want to start a war. That's why I was quiet, because I figured there was more to this story. Brother Little, Skunk's, really, Brother Little?
Elton should have missed out on that part.
No. I was taking notes and writing it all in.
We should have had everybody sign a disclaimer before we started.
Hey, the statute of limitations is over. You know,
this story here was just found out, so that don't apply to me with this one here.
Wait a minute, Ethel. If you go back in our past, we can go back in yours.
Wait a minute. Now, Sister Little, supposed to stick together. Now, this is the Brother Littles now.
I bet Abe's got a few things he could help me out with.
He ain't going to say nothing, because I'll tell you the reason he really don't have no hair. So he ain't going to say
nothing. That's all right. But I have plenty of them on you, though.
You know, Ed said, he said, oh, they would never catch it like we were.
Man, my daddy would have got that gun about 3 or 4 times with them boys.
Gotta go. It was great seeing everybody.
Yeah, same here, Jason. Give everybody our regards. Still tell me.
Same here.
Bye-bye.
I'm going to say bye too, but I enjoyed it, Brother Little. That was good.
Thank you
so much. Okay, bye-bye.
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 Hey,
bye-bye, Patricia.
Hi. Bernard, he came and sit in on it.
Huh?
Bernard was sitting. He was listening.
Oh, good.
I'm glad.
Tell the boy said hey.
Okay, all right.
Here.
Well, I enjoyed everything.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And you